and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you, I praise you, I love you, I worship you, I adore you, I glorify name. Thank you, Jesus, praise you, Jesus, love you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I surrender myself to you, my whole being. Holy Spirit, take control of my tongue, my vocal cord. Holy Spirit, I am not speaking, it is you who is speaking through me. Holy Spirit, make this teaching easy and understandable. I pray this mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good evening, brothers and sisters. Today I am going to share the word is reconciliation with God. Praise God. Can we believe this night God is calling to us and saying, come now, let us settle this once for all, now. God wants you and me always, always to be blessed, just as we want our children to be blessed. We want everything good for our children, and we too are a child of God. And therefore, the word of God says that God always has plans for our welfare and never for our destruction. It is in the mind of God, the plan of God, that he always wants to do good things to you and me. But he cannot do those good things in our life when we are living in sin. And therefore, God invites you and me and saying, come now. He is not saying, come tomorrow. But he's saying, come now. Come now, let us argue. Out says the Lord, though your sins like scarlet, they shall be like snow. The word of God clearly shows here, no matter what your sins are, no matter how big sins are, when you come to Jesus and repent all your sins, he can take care of all those sins. I remember a testimony of a young lady. She was married to a young man, and they had a beautiful married life. But there was one thing that this woman never happy. This young man began to give her everything he could, but this woman was never happy. As years went by, they became rich, and this young man provided everything to his wife. But she was not at all happy. He took her many places for retreats, for reconciliation, for counseling, and everything. But this woman was not at peace. So he brought her to a counselor. And this counselor began to speak. And she told him, before I got married, I committed a sin. And it was such a deadly sin that I know I cannot be forgiven. And she was feeling guilty about that sin, and because of which she could not enjoy her married life. So counselor began to ask her, did you confess your sins? She said, yes, I confessed. So the counselor said, believe your sins are forgiven. But she said, I don't know whether my sins are forgiven because my sin is so great that God is unable to forgive my sin. So this counselor said, let me explain to you. Let's take for example, you and I are taking a walk at the banks of a river, and it is evening and the sun is about to set, and you are just walking along the bank and everything seems to be calm and the water is calm, and let us sit down there. And he told her, let us do one thing. You take the weight of your sin, that big stone, and I will also take a stone of my sin. So he picked up a stone and he said, I am going to throw this stone into the water. And he threw that stone into the water. And he asked her, what did you see? And she said, I see the stone go down, and there was big splash, and the water was shaking all around. And then he asked her, what happened? She said, the water is calm now. Then he said to her, now you take the stone according to your sin. And she said, She said, I cannot carry the stone. It is too big for me. So the counselor said, let me help you. And they both carried the stone. And he said, come now. And now throw. And throw the stone into the water. And they both threw the stone into the water. And he asked her, tell me, what did you see? She said, I saw a big splash. The whole water was disturbed. And he asked her, what happened to the stone? She said, the stone went down. Now, what do you see? She said, the water is calm. Then he asked her, tell me, can you see my stone? She said, no. Can you see your stone? She said, no. And that's exactly what it is of Jesus. No matter what your sins are, when you give it to Jesus and repent from your heart, every sin is taken care of. There is no sin that Jesus cannot forgive. And once he has forgiven, he will never see that sin again in your life. Praise the Lord. That's what the Bible says. The Lord remembers sin no more. He throws the sin so far as the distance between east and the west. The east and the west, they never meet. He throws your sins behind his back, never to see them again. But he can do that only when you come to him. And that's what he's saying. Come now, not tomorrow. Today is the day that God is calling you to reconcile. Today is the day when God is calling you to confess. You know, we all used to say confession. You know what is the meaning of confession? Can anyone unmute and tell me? What is the meaning of confession? Anyone?
Confession, if we go in the church, it is confess our sins, repent for our sins, renew our minds.
Yes, sister. Confession means to say as it is. If we twist the meaning, it is no longer confession. Confession means to speak as it is. And it is saying to you, even though your sins are red as a scarlet, don't worry, I can take care of it. Because the blood of his Jesus, the son Jesus, and God is saying, I will make you white as snow. Though our sins are red like the crimson, they shall become like wool. If we are willing and obedient, we shall eat the good of the Lamb. I tell you, if we messed up our life today, today is the day of greatest miracle of all. God wants to reconcile. He wants to restore friendship. Because if we are in sin, the Bible says, the person who sins is a child of a devil and not of a child of God. And today God is saying, if we are willing and we are ready to take that decision and obey what I am saying, you and I will eat the good of the Lamb. But if we refuse and rebel, we shall be devoured by the sword. The choice is given to each one of us. And he says, if we take the decision and go and confess our sins from our heart, please listen, brothers and sisters. There can be a person who can go for confession and cry over there and confess his sin and come back without repentance. And there can be another person who can go and confess his sin and not even shed a single drop of tear and come back with a repentant heart. So, what is the meaning of word repentance? What is the meaning of the word confession? Confession means to speak as it is. And repentance means to make a decision. To make a decision, no to sin forever. Repentance is not crying. Repentance is not on feelings. Repentance is not your and my decision to say no to sin. Repentance is on my and your decision to say no to sin and yes to Lord Again, in Isaiah 59, the word of God says, see, the Lord's hand is not too short to save, or his ears dull to hear. Rather, your iniquities have been barriers between you and your God. It is not that God deaf, that he cannot hear you. It is not God, his hands are short, he cannot save you. But he is saying that sin that brought separation between God and man. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, the word of God says, if you obey my word, if you obey the Lord your God by diligently observing all his commandments that I am commanding you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you obey the Lord your God. The principle works always when we are obedient to God, when we are obedient to God's word. Your house is built on rock and you are a wise man. Every time you disobey God's word, you are being foolish, and your house is built on sand and it shall be destroyed. The whole chapter of Deuteronomy speaks about obedience and disobedience. And if we read in obedience, there are so many beautiful blessings over there. Let me read it. Blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the field. Blessed shall be your fruit of womb, the fruit of your ground, the fruit of your livestock, the increase of your cattle, the issue of your flock. Blessed shall be your basket, kneading bowl. Blessed shall be when you come in, and blessed shall be when you go out. The Lord will cause your enemies who arise against you to be defeated before you. They shall come out against you one way and flee before you seven ways. So many blessings are there. But the Bible again in the same chapter says in verse number 15, but if you not obey Lord your God by diligently observing all his commandments and decrees which I am commanding today, then all these curses shall come upon you and overtake you. You don't require somebody to come and curse you. But the very moment you disobey God, curse is already come into existence, into your life and in my life. And today is the day that God has given us opportunity to confess our sins and is faithful to forgive us of all our sins. In 1 John 1:7 says, if we walk with the light as he himself the light, we are fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all our sins. He says all sins, not some sin, but cleanses us from all sin. Jesus is saying again and again in the word of God, that God wants us to reconcile. God wants us to come out of sin and move and walk in his way. And one of the beautiful examples Jesus gave us is the prodigal son. We see over there are two sons, one elder, one younger. The younger son wanted to enjoy his life. He took what was with his father. He took a share of it, went to a distant country, and spent all that he had. His father had given him something very special that his father had earned all his life. And when he gave it to his son, even though the son received it from his father, he was not satisfied. He wanted to go away from his father's side. And therefore, he went to a distant land. And here Jesus is comparing two different kingdoms. One, the kingdom of his father, and the one, the kingdom of the enemy. And the Bible says, when he went to that kingdom, he spent all that he had with his friends, with all wrong things. When he spent all that he had, the Bible says, in that kingdom, there was famine. The good news is, in the kingdom of God, there is never a famine. Because in the God's kingdom, there is blessing and blessing and blessing. In the enemy's field, there is always destruction and famine. and there was famine in that place, and he had lost everything. And when he had lost everything, he was walking in sin. His mind was so much hardened that he even refused to understand his own identity. And he began to work in a place where he had to take care of the pigs. Sin led him to so much of his downfall that he was feeding the pig. And there came a time when he was hungry. Even the food of the pigs, he began to eat. That's exactly what happens when a person is living in sin. Everything that God has blessed you and me, and when we abuse it, it shall end up with destruction. Your eyes and your heart will be hardened, and that's the work of the devil to keep you away from the kingdom of God. And this young man lost everything. He lost even his identity in that kingdom. And there came a time when he was starving. In the devil's kingdom, the devil will always give you pleasure, but in exchange of pleasure, he will take your soul. He will come as a pleasure and end up with destruction in your life and in my life also. The same thing happened to the prodigal son. And one fine day, that God, by the grace of God, it is only by the grace of God that one fine day, he came to his senses. The Bible says, one day he came to his senses and he realized that in his father's house, even the servants had better food, had better clothing, better life. But in this kingdom, there was no life. There was only slavery. And there was only destruction. He came to his senses and he said, I will go back to my father. Praise the Lord. Many a times in our life also, God gives us grace after grace after grace. His grace is always overflowing in our lives. But are we sensitive to accept what Jesus did on the cross for you and me? When he came to his senses, he took a decision. He said, I am going home. And when I am going home, I tell my father, I am not even worthy to be called your son. I am coming to you. Deal with me just as deal with the servant. Whenever we go for a confession, we cannot go for confession with your worthiness, because we all got disqualified. The Bible says all of us have sinned. All of us have fallen short of the glory of the God. You and I are supposed to live in this planet Earth for the glory of God. Now, what is the glory? Can anyone tell me what is the glory? Can anyone tell me? The meaning of the word glory is God's invisible power made manifested. Yes, sister?
Abundance of God?
No, sister. The meaning of the word glory is God's invisible power made manifested so that you and I see with naked eyes in God's glory. In other words, people look at you, they can see God in you and me. They can see God working in you and in me. They can see the love of God flowing in us. They can see God's image in you and me. They can see the power of God in you and me. And that's what God has called us to live in this planet Earth. And that's how Adam lived. He was covered with the glory of God. So when we come back to the Father and we begin to live a good life of righteousness, not self-righteousness, but righteousness in faith in Jesus, by obeying his word, we will be covered with God's glory. Praise the Lord. So this young man has decided to come back to his father, and he comes back not with his own worthiness, because he has got disqualified. Every person in this planet have got disqualified, because the Bible says, all of us, like sheep, have gone astray with our own ways. And according to the word of God, all those who disobedient to the commandments of God are under God's curse. But the good news is today, Jesus wants to set each and every one of us free from every curse. And that is when every one of us confess our sins. Whenever a sinner comes to the God, he does not come to the boldness, but he comes with all his unworthiness, and God qualifies him. And that's what the word of God says in Colossians 1, that we are qualified and translated into the kingdom of his son Jesus, from the powers of darkness into the kingdom of light. None of us are qualified to enter into the heavenly kingdom, but it is only because of the love of God, the grace of God, that he has given us the power to become children of God. And it is only by him that we are made worthy to stand in his presence. Praise the Lord. Now, when his son decides to come back, the Bible says, even when he was far away, his father saw him. Praise the Lord. Can you imagine that even when the son was far away, the father saw him? Even though the son could not see his father in the distant land, Jesus is saying the father was waiting for his son every moment the son had left him. And every moment his eyes were fixed on his son. Even now, the same heavenly father's eyes fixed on you and me. No matter how far we have gone, his eyes is fixed on you and me. And he is making ways for us to come back. The son came back when he went deep down into the pit. And then he came to his senses. Do we all have to go down to the deep pit to come to our senses, or can we come to our senses right now? Which do we prefer? I was not like him. Even though I heard the word of God, I refused to believe till I went deep down in the pit. That pit, I went down and I was helpless. I was crying to the Lord. But praise God, I have God of mercy, love and compassion. And he did not abandon me. And he got me out of that pit. Praise the Lord. But it is necessary everyone go into the pit and then come out. Can we come out right now? Which one is better? And the Bible says, even when he was far away, his father saw him. I tell you, this night, before we came, the father was looking at you and me. He had been waiting for a long time. And today is the day. He is waiting for you and me. He's waiting for you and me with his arms wide open. Because the Bible says, when he saw his son, the father ran toward the son. The son did not run to the father because he was unworthy. He was full of fear. But the father ran to the son. That is our heavenly father. And this night, he is ready with his arms open, wide, runs towards you and me. And what did he do? He ran to his son, hugged him, kissed him, and accepted him. His son, when he was living in the distant land without any money, without any food, and working among the pigs, he must be thinking, he must be smelling, he must be full of beard, he must be shabby, his clothes were torn, no footwear, yet his father recognized his son. No matter how deep you and me are gone in your life, you made a mess out of your life, no one can recognize you and me, who you are. But the heavenly father can recognize you and me. That's you are his child. And even before you go to the confession, the heavenly father will come running towards you. He is the one who hugs you, who loves you, who kisses you, who accepts you. Then he listened to our confession. Isn't that great? That's what Jesus said. The Heavenly Father is full of love. No matter what you have done, the moment we took a decision to come out of that place and come to the kingdom of God, the Heavenly Father makes the move. When we make the first move, and then only he accepts your confessions. And the moment he accepts your confession, he forgives you that very moment. That you might say, brother, I can't see, I might be forgiven. It is by faith. And what is the first thing he does? The first thing he does is he puts a robe on you. What is that robe? The robe is robe of righteousness. And that's why Isaiah 61 verse 10, the Bible says, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. He is not saying I will rejoice in the Lord, but he say, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. Why? My whole being shall exalt my God, for he clothed me garments of salvation. He says, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. I will exalt in his name. Why? Because God has clothed me with the garments of salvation. Now you have heard the name salvation before. The word salvation in Hebrew means Yahshua, and in Greek it is called soteria. And the meaning of it is freedom from sin. It means protection. It means healing. It means preservation. It means good health. It means prosperity. It means eternal life. It means nothing broken, nothing missing in your life and in my life. And what is the Bible says? I will greatly rejoice because my God has clothed me with the garments of healing, with the garments of prosperity, with the garment of protection, with the garment of eternal life, with the garment of preservation, with the garment of overcoming sin and death, with the garment of the authority over the powers of darkness, having victory over the powers of darkness. Now that is salvation. So he is saying, I will greatly rejoice because God has clothed me with the garment. And listen what he is saying. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. Whenever I read this, I like that. You know what he is saying. Our health, our prosperity, our protection, victory over sin, victory over the powers of darkness, eternal life. All this according to the word of God is our undergarments. And he's saying the robe of righteousness, your outer garments. Now, what is the meaning of righteousness? Righteousness does not means holiness. Righteousness means the nature of God planted in you and me. Holiness means the way you conduct your life in your day-to-day life, your action. But the righteousness means the nature of God. Righteousness is what you are, praise the Lord. And the Bible says, when the prodigal son came back, the father took the robe of righteousness and put it on his son. In other words, he planted the nature of God in him. I hope all you are understanding. So, when a sinner comes back to Jesus and say, Jesus, I want to accept you as my Lord, God, and Savior. Jesus not only forgives him for his sin, but the Heavenly Father now gives him the power and makes him a child of God and puts the nature of God in that person. And that's why the Bible says that I will greatly rejoice now because the nature of God is planted in me. Isn't that a good news? God is not only forgiving your sin, but putting his very nature in you and me. With this nature of righteousness, we can overcome not only sin, but Satan and everything that he holds. If you read very carefully in James chapter 5, verse 16, the word of God says, the prayer of the righteous one is powerful. Prayer of the righteous one is effective. Now, when we go for confession and we confess all our sin, not only those sins are forgiven, but after the confession, we are clothed with the robe of righteousness and we come back with the nature of God. And the Bible says, whatever you believe, so shall it be. Now we might say, brother, I do not know yet, because you did not know, you could not enjoy the life abundance after your confession. If you read James chapter 5, he says, the prayer of the righteous one is powerful. And how do we get the righteousness of God? We get the righteousness of God is through faith in Jesus. And that's what is said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. He says, Jesus, who knew no sin, God made him to be sin, not a sinner, but a sin, so that we could be made the righteousness of God. In another word, when we look at the cross of Jesus, whatever was in Jesus comes into us, and whatever in us goes in his body. So every sin he carried in his body, and every righteousness of him comes to in us by faith. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I want to tell you to understand, if you commit one sin, according to the word of God, we all destined to go to hell. But God changed that situation by sending his son to die in our place. And when he died in our place, he took care of all our sin. Now he says, I open the door for you and for me to just receive the blessing by faith and walk from now on in the light, because now I put that power in you. I have given you the very nature of my son in you. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Love you, Jesus. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I praise you. I love you. Father, we thank you for this great opportunity given to us. Lord, we come together this night to listen to your word that brings transformation in our life. Thank you, Holy Spirit, helping me to speak through me and make this teaching easy and understandable in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. I would just like to clarify to people on one point over here. When brother spoke about Deuteronomy, over there the blessings are written and curses are written. Okay? So, from verse number 15, we see that, you know, the Lord says that if you do not turn, or if you do not walk in righteousness, or if you do not obey the law, you will be cursed, or all that many things will come upon you. Okay? Now, many of us may go into that mode of thinking, oh, this is happening to me because the Lord is cursing me. This is happening to me because, you know, it is written. So please don't go into that mode of thinking. It's not like that. It was what was under the law. We are now under grace. Understand that very clearly. Okay? It should not be, oh, it is written in the Bible, so it is. Now, why do people then to tend to fall into that? Because they do not reconcile. That is because they do not choose to obey the commands or walk in righteousness. They do not repent. They do not renew their minds. They have not taken the U-turn. So what happens is, when they are following the same old life, what are they doing? They are operating in the kingdom of darkness. They are not operating in the kingdom of light. So when you are operating in the kingdom of darkness, you get everything from the kingdom of darkness. Okay? Then when you are operating from there, you are getting from there means you cannot say, it is written in the Bible that God has told I will get this. No. Not at all. It is because you have not chose to change yourself. Okay? Once we repent, once we renew our mind, once we surrender ourselves to God, now we get the righteousness from Jesus. He has earned that righteousness by taking away our sins, by taking away our sickness, everything, our curse, everything is taken on the cross. So we earn it from him once we repent, once we renew our minds, once we go to him, once we surrender to him. So keep this very clear, okay? So no, there should be no misunderstanding of the scriptures. So that's why I chose to just speak about it a little more so that people should not feel, oh, it's written in the Bible that, you know, God will curse us, God will do this, God will punish. No, 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 no. It's nothing like that. It is because we don't choose to go in the light. We are in the darkness. So what happens when we are in the kingdom of a particular king? We are going to have only what that king gives us. If we are in the darkness, the king of darkness is Satan, Lucifer, whatever belongs to him, he will give us. And there comes all sickness, all curses, all everything that we do not want in our lives. But when we turn ourselves, when we repent ourselves, when we now know the word, now we change our hearts, now we are only for the Lord. Now we see that supernatural life what the Lord has called us for. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I hope this is very clear to everyone. That's why I wanted to just be, even before stopping the recording, I wanted this to go on air also, as many will be hearing this teaching. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Love you, Jesus. Amen. Amen.